I agree. This is a really exciting topic, and it's exactly the right time, which is, I think, the real strength of vLab is they sort of, I don't know, have some magic crystal ball that gets exactly the right people in the right places together at exactly the moment they should be. So I am tasked with getting the ball rolling a little bit, getting everybody kind of on the same page. Microbiome is a new topic for a lot of people. Even the scientists and the experts who spend all day long just working on that still find a lot of surprising things every single day. So I'm sure that all of you in the audience will as well. So my job, as I said, is to get us all on the same page. And I've got a somewhat lighthearted, hopefully entertaining and interesting introduction that will get us all talking about some of the key issues that the microbiome can help solve, some of the challenges it faces, and how even you might be a part of doing that. I'd also like to thank my colleagues Camilla Stice and Kevin Pang, who did a lot of the research that I'm going to be showing you here. This is a little bit of our study of the space where companies are commercializing microbiome research. So, three questions to start out. First, what's a microbiome? This is not a rhetorical question. I would like you to answer. What's a microbiome? I don't know. If I knew, then I would know. Any suggestions? Any thoughts?
Very small
bacteria. It's a small biome. It's a 1/1000th of a biome. Okay, that was good. It's a small biome. Why is it small? What's in it? Yes. Yes, it's a community. It's an ecosystem of bacteria. So lots of different kinds. They play lots of different roles. It's not just one single thing. And that's, in fact, the next question. Where is the microbiome?
Everywhere.
That's good. Okay.
Inside
you and outside. Yes. It's on babies. Babies are full of germs. We know that. But microbiomes exist all over the place. So your gut, that's the one we're going to be focusing on tonight, and that's probably the most famous one. But your skin, your eyes, your hair, lots of places in and on our bodies have microbiomes, as well as there's a soil microbiome. For crops to thrive, there needs to be a good ecosystem of bacteria. In the air, in the water, all these places are home to various microbiomes. Some of those microbes that we'll be looking at in just a second, again, vary from person to person, from place to place, even from time to time. How big is a microbiome? Somebody said it was very small. It is actually maybe a half a pound, I believe, is the sort of estimate in your body. But of the 10 to hundreds of trillions of cells you've got in your body, there are basically 10 times more of those microbes in and on your body. And a lot of people get picked out by that. I assume everybody that you've gotten this far, you're at least over the hump that you know enough about the microbiome that's the case. We're outnumbered, but that's a good thing because the vast majority of these microbes are beneficial. So again, keeping in lighthearted vein, this is a little picture from a yogurt container that's scientifically accurate to 7 or 8 decimal points. It's exactly 80% of the microbes that are beneficial and exactly 20% that are not. And they have little wings like that, too. These are micrographs, SEM pictures. All right. So moving from, again, this kind of big picture to some more specifics. As I said, you've got one genome forever. And that's been a lot of the focus of science for the last 10 years or more has been the human genome. You know, the Human Genome Project and the amazing discoveries that has produced and the basically ease with which we can now measure and find out about our own DNA and the DNA around us was one of the things that really led to us discovering all this diversity in the microbiome. So the complexity of the microbiome is really difficult to overstate. If you look all around your body, again, you've got lots of different combinations of microbiomes. Those change over time. They change from person to person. And we're at this point right now, again, vLab has exquisite timing because we're really just past the point where all those errors and things that seem to not make sense and kind of question marks are starting to form a corpus, a body of knowledge, a body of understanding that can be turned into therapies and diagnostics and other types of things that benefit us. So as we get to know, to understand that, that's basically led to correlation with a number of different diseases. So things like that are, you know, very obviously linked to your bowel, like inflammatory bowel disease, diabetes and obesity, metabolic syndrome, things that we would naturally associate with the gut. It's pretty clear that those correlations have existed, but now we can understand what classes of microbes are upregulated or downregulated. They're present in more, or greater, or less, fewer quantities than we would expect in a healthy biome. But we're also seeing diseases that you might not have thought of as related to gut health, like liver disease or cancer or even mental health. So again, these are associations. We don't know for sure the causal mechanism, but we're finding those things out thanks to a lot of the research that's being done in universities like Stanford and at the startups like we have on our panel tonight. So in contrast to this growing scientific body, we also have a lot of folk remedies, a lot of like stories about what's good for your gut, what's not. And there are a lot of foods that are that contain what are called probiotics. These are basically things that replace or augment that bacterial flora you have in your body. And I wrote here very explicitly, thought to replace beneficial gut bacteria. This is an area of a lot of pseudoscience. There's a lot of hopeful, you know, guesswork. And it certainly would be nice to think that if we ate enough beer, kimchi, and yogurt, we'd all be in good shape. This, by the way, is not any kind of a dietary recommendation, like four beers or, okay, quantity-wise, but feel free to experiment. But anyway, we know that there is an association with food. We just don't understand that. And we were just talking just before I came up here about recently there was some news that a lot of these supposed, you know, probiotic foods actually contain no bacteria whatsoever of the kind that they purport to contain. So there's a lot of contrast here too between popular science, if you will, and more structured to traditional science. Now that's the top side of the gut. On the other side, there are also ways of treating this. And these two are being explored in ways that are sometimes rigorous and sometimes not. So as you've probably ascertained at this point, these are bacteria that live in your gut. You can take a pill and get them into your gut, or there are other means by which you can do that. And let's just say they involve a blender. If you just do a Google search on fecal transplantation, you can probably figure out what that means. This is literally this is a screenshot. I didn't sort of sort these or do anything special. So there's the Fecal Transplant Foundation with the new acronym FMT, which does roll off the lips a little bit more easy than fecal transplant. Quick, inexpensive, and a 90% cure rate, Mayo Clinic. So that's a Mayo Clinic. I think that the rate can only go down from 90%. How to safely do a fecal transplant at home, DIY. You're going to want to click on that as soon as you get home, I'm sure. And then you get, kids, guess what? So there's a lot of news that's coming out about where these things go wrong. So very recently, just about a week or so ago, there was a story of a woman who gained 41 pounds after she'd gotten a fecal transplant. Now, again, correlation, causation, we don't know what was actually going on there, but we know that this is one of those types of stories that might move the science forward, or it might totally, you know, change the discussion, basically. Is this the way to go? There's also earned nearly $500,000 by selling your poo. You're going to want to find that one, too. So, again, this is typical for early stage science and typical for the type of thing, again, when VLab hits the timing here, there is a lot of hype that starts to pick up in the space. If you read Gartner stuff, you know about the hype cycle. It applies in everything, even fecal matter transplant or fecal transplants. So to counter all this stuff that's going out in the wild, we have a lot of research money going into real academic research. So hundreds of millions of dollars. There's actually, you can't quite read that, at least a dozen more programs like this around the world where the Human Microbiome Project, META, HIT, these are all looking at a more scientific and more rigorous understanding of the microbiome so we can actually have therapies and diagnostics that really do work. So one of the things that we do at Lux, we track the number of scientific papers in a given area. And as you can see, this is tracking gut microbiome is the dark blue bars, microbiome is the light blue bars. The number of publications with those terms in their search is going up really rapidly. So, you know, we're in the thousands per year for both of those categories, and the trajectory, I think, is going to continue to rise. So when that science starts to turn into, you know, products and services that can be commercialized, that's where we see this, a large number of startups forming a new industry around this space. So we're going to be hearing from Second Genome on the panel and from Whole Biome in the next presentation. I told Colleen I made this twice as big as everybody else's because she has the job of presenting in just a second. But at any rate, there's a lot going on in the space, and I think that this number will actually continue to grow. This isn't sort of the peak by any means. We'll see a number of new companies entering the space, looking for funding, having some new take on the, it might be the bioinformatics side of it, it might be some other aspect of this microbiome space. So just to give you an example, some idea, some concept of what's going on, some investments and advances recently in microbiome startups. Nestle Health just made a $75 million investment in Ceres Health to help them go to phase 3 trials with some microbiome-based drugs against Clostridium difficile. Ventana is taking another drug. They just licensed out to Janssen Biotech, and their milestone payments and other things might lead to up to $240 million for them. Second Genome is advancing to a phase 1 clinical trial for treatment of Crohn's disease. Optics Health and a Dutch company called Nizo are looking at a JV to commercialize a probiotic yogurt. 40 Farmer just raised $51 million to help bring two of their candidates to trials. And this all happened just in January. It's a very happening space. And like I said, I think there's a lot more to come. So with that, thank you very much. I will be here taking your questions. We have a number that we can use. It's in your program. If you want to start texting questions, they'll go into a little file that I'll be able to see, and we'll be able to ask your questions. So thank you. We'll be around all later for questions as well. And now, Colleen, do you want to come up and tell us more about Whole Biome?
Thanks, Mark. So first of all, thank you to everyone for taking time out of your evening to join us. Hopefully, we can continue to be educational and entertaining. So about 2 years ago, me and my two co-founders were in a bar. After a few beers, we made the decision that there are very specific types of data and quality of data that are going to be needed in order to develop therapeutics and diagnostics in the microbiome space. After a few more beers and moving into bourbon, we decided that, hey, you know, between the three of us, we have the expertise to be able to generate this type of data that's going to help develop therapeutics and diagnostics in the microbiome space. And then several rounds after that, we decided, you know what, we should start a company. And we are going to make this data, and then we're going to make the therapeutics and the diagnostics in the microbiome space. And it's going to be awesome. We're going to help people. We're going to be part of this new revolution in medicine. And, you know, maybe we'll make a buck or two along the way. It's going to be great. And so a new startup idea was born. And so I can see maybe some other people here have done this same process to come up with a startup idea. So the next morning, I made a pot of coffee, and I called my co-founders up. And I said, why don't you guys come over? Let's talk about what we discussed last night. And what we decided was that we needed to figure out whether the idea we had was a good idea or not. And so we said, let's go find out who are the people who are in the space right now. Let's tell them we think this is the kind of data that's needed to propel the space forward. Do you think it's a good idea, or do you think we're just a bunch of drunk alcoholics? Maybe we're both. But in any case, is this a good idea? So we bought a bunch of plane tickets. We flew around the country. We talked to academic researchers. We talked to clinicians. We talked to other microbiome companies. And all of them said, you know, yeah, that's the kind of data we need. And if you start a company, I'll work with you. So we came back, and we felt really good. We had an idea. It had been validated. Now all we needed was money. No problem. So we said, well, how much money do we need? OK, well, we need to get a lab. We need equipment for that lab. We got to pay ourselves salary. Maybe we need some other people to help us out. So we need about $5 million. So I didn't know how to get $5 million. I didn't even know who to ask. So I called Hugh Martin, who was the previous CEO of PacBio. He was able to raise hundreds of millions of dollars in what was considered a drought economy. Nobody was able to raise any money. And so I said, this guy knows how to raise money. I'm going to ask him. So I called him. I said, Hugh, we need $5 million to start a company. What do we do? And he said, OK, Colleen, there are these people. They're called venture capitalists. And they fund good ideas. So let me know how I can help you. I can make intros, whatever. So I said, great. Yeah, I'd love to meet a venture capitalist. Let me tell them my idea. So I sat down with them and I said, you know, the microbiome is this huge opportunity. And we have the ability to create the kind of data that's going to be necessary to capitalize on that opportunity. And I need $5 million. What do you say? And so their feedback, this is the problem with investors. Sorry, I'll be politically correct. The problem that I had with the investors that I met was that what I really needed was for someone to, they're too polite. I needed someone to grab me by the collar and say, Colleen, you just told me there's a lot of money over here, and you're standing here, and what I need you to tell me is how you're going to bring that money in a very specific plan into your pockets, and more importantly, into my pockets. And you don't have that plan. But instead, what they said was, that's nice, we love your idea, let us know how your progress comes along and as you move forward. So brings you back to the question, well, is this really a good idea? So then we thought, remember those people that we flew around the country and they said that if we start a company, they want to work with us? Let's call them out on it. So we go back to all those people and we said, we started a company, will you pay for us to generate the data that you said was important? And they all said, yes. And so we then said, great, who's going to fund this idea? It's the people who are already in the space. So when people say yes on the phone, that's not the same as actually writing a check. If you've ever been in sales, sold Girl Scout cookies or Christmas paper, or sold yourself in a job interview, you know that you get a lot of, you know, positive feedback, but you never know when somebody's actually going to commit to you. And one day I got a phone call, and this guy said, all right, Colleen, we're in. We got $30,000. Where do I wire the money to? And I thought, oh my gosh, $30,000. Okay, well, should he send it to my personal account? That seems not professional. I don't really know where he should send this money to. So I called Hugh again, and I said, we got some money. What do I do? And he said, okay, you'll go to a place that's called Silicon Valley Bank, and you'll open up an account there, and that's where the money can be wired to. I said, great. So I get on my computer and I look up my local Silicon Valley Bank, and there's one right here in Palo Alto off Oregon, and drive over there, and I go to open the door and it's locked. I'm like, okay, it's 11 o'clock in the morning on a Thursday. These guys work worse hours than I do. So, pull on it again, and this woman comes and she kind of cracks open the door. She says, can I help you? And I said, well, yeah, I'd like to open a bank account. I have money. And she said, okay, well, this is sort of a by appointment only kind of bank. And I said, that's great. I'd like to make an appointment to open a bank account. And she was very polite, but she essentially sent me on my way. I did eventually figure out how to open a bank account and deposit money in, and Silicon Valley Bank is a great bank. We've been with them. But it just goes to show you how naive we were when we first started this company. So now I had $30,000 in the bank account. So now all I needed was $4,970,000 to go. And that's when I met Doug Crawford. And Doug said, there's this place, and it's called QB3, and it's magical. It's an incubator, and you can rent as little or as much as you need. You can rent one bench, you could rent a bench in an office, and you don't have to spend those millions on equipment, because we have equipment, and you just have to pay to rent it. And by the way, we're also affiliated with UCSF, and you'll have access to all their core equipment, and you just have to pay to rent it. And I thought, that is pretty awesome. It's Candyland. And then Doug introduced me to J-Labs. And J-Labs said, well, we are also part of Candyland. And we have additional equipment that you'll have access to, plus more resources that are complementary with QB3 to help you build a company, since you obviously don't know what you're doing. And so this was great. So we were now in a very happy place. We had $30,000 in our bank account. We quit our jobs. And we started Whole Biome. And over the first year of operations, we actually brought in a little over $500,000 in pure revenue selling the type of data that we could generate. And that's how we funded this company. So after a while, you realize that bringing in money and revenue is nice, but it'd kind of be nice to have a bolus of money that you can really build this company on. And so you can't completely ignore the VCs. You got to go back to them. And in these discussions, you know, is this really a good idea, and who will fund this idea merge, they're really kind of the same question. And so this time around, we went to VCs. This is how it went. I said, we have this company. We have the ability to generate top-tier data that people who are actually in the microbiome space, including other microbiome companies, want to use. We've been able to pull in revenue for this. And I would like to get some more money in order to really build out this pipeline and get the kind of data that's going to add value to the company. And then Chicago says, OK, so you're a service company. And I said, yeah, we're a service company. OK. Venture capitalists don't really fund service companies. So I said, okay. Went to our next round of meetings, and I said, I have a discovery platform that can be used to generate data that can build therapeutics and diagnostics in the microbiome space. It's a huge space, it's gonna be great. And they said, okay, so you're a platform technology. I said, platform technology, that's great, that's what we are. And they said, yeah, venture capitalists don't usually fund platform technologies. If you had a diagnostic and you're using your platform technology, that'd be great, totally, we'd be in. So we said, okay, we go to our next round of meetings and said, we're a diagnostics company. We have a platform technology, and we're going to build diagnostics for a whole bunch of indications with this platform. And they said, that is great. Diagnostics don't really make a lot of money. And look, you know, there's new regulations coming down the pike about lab diagnostic testing. We don't really want to get in the space. If you had a therapeutic, we would totally talk to you. So we go to our next round of meetings. This is real. We go to our next round of meetings, and I say, we are a microbiome therapeutics company. We're building therapeutics. We have a platform technology that can be used to generate therapeutics in a wide variety of indications. And they said, it's interesting, because if I understand your technology right, that means that you could make therapeutics and diagnostics, maybe even a service. Seems like you're limiting yourself by being a therapeutic. I mean, you're really a platform technology. I'd fund a platform technology, but you're just like a therapeutics company. And just a few weeks ago at JP Morgan, I had a meeting in which I went in and said, we're a platform technology, we can make therapeutics and diagnostics. This is all, you know, we've really, you know, paid our dues, shown that we can generate this great data. And the guy, I kid you not, said to me, I think at this time in the microbiome space, a service company is really where you need to be. And if you want to make this a service company, call me and we will fund that. So I literally went full circle. And so here's the things that I learned. I learned, first of all, I now understand what a business model is. I know it's not just, you know, here's the money and here's me. I now know about six different business models. And the second thing I know is that nobody, but nobody, knows how to monetize in this space and knows how it's really going to play out. And so what do you do with this information when you're trying to start a company? And I think the only thing you can do is to take a moment and block out all the jargon and the terminology and the five pillars of every successful business plan and say, what do I think is a good microbiome company? How do I think we can make a change in this space? And so you go back to the fundamental principles. You go back to the beginning. You go back to the bar. And you remember that you had an idea at this bar. And that idea was, there are specific high quality types of data that need to be generated so that therapeutics and diagnostics can be made by you in order to change lives. And this is Whole Biome. We are going to help people. We are going to be a part of a revolutionary wave in the way we think about medicine. And we might make a buck or two along the way.
Okay, thanks. So I think you got your $30,000 worth for your ticket tonight. I hope you got a lot. Thanks, Colleen. Okay, so I thought it was really interesting that you didn't mention anything about the microbiome the entire time. I mean, you could just talk about your entrepreneurial, you know, your startup experience. And while the microbiome certainly is fascinating, I think this intersection between venture capital and something that's pretty new is really what VLab is about. So just kind of going down the line here. So Karim, you've also been through this experience. And Jackie, I think you've probably seen it from various angles. Doug, I know you have. So if you could, just tell us, first of all, a little bit about yourselves and your company. And then you know, some of your experience commercializing the microbiome technology.
So good evening. My name is Karim Dabbagh. I'm the CSO at Second Genome. I've only been with Second Genome since last August, so I never went through the cycle that you just described, but Second Genome went through, I think, pretty much the same idea. Just a little bit of background. Prior to joining Second Genome, I was with a large company, Pfizer, where I was leading microbiome research within the therapy areas. That was, besides J&J, one of the other companies that really wanted to actually get into this area and recognizing the importance of the host and the microflora interactions in the state of health and disease. Prior to that, I started a small company in 2009 and did exactly what you just described, but on a very accelerated time frame. Before that, I was in the Bay Area with Roche Pharmaceuticals and then at Stanford as a postdoc. Actually, coming back full circle, I came here for my second fellowship to study what was at the time called the hygiene hypothesis, which was the theory behind why we should not be using Clorox because too much cleanliness was resulting in allergies and increased incidence of various autoimmune diseases. So we were trying to model that in experimental systems here at a time when there was no next generation sequencing and when you still cultured bacteria on plates and it was a nightmare. So, you know, a lot of the work was not published because it was not really reproducible. So in a nutshell, that's my background.
Jackie?
Yeah, so thank you. I work for J&J Innovation and we have a site located just down the street in Menlo Park. And we actually have three other sites. We have one in Boston, one in London, and one in Shanghai. So we basically cover the world. And we're really involved in partnering on behalf of J&J. So I represent immunology, for example. And so I'm the face of immunology for external partnering. And in fact, Second Genome is our first microbiome partnership through the Innovation Center. We have a number of other partnerships. We actually, through my Boston colleagues, were responsible for the Vedanta partnership that was mentioned above. It started with an investment in 2013, and then we made the big announcement in January that you alluded to. So we've been working in the microbiome space for a long time. Actually, to the credit of my colleagues who were at Janssen, which is the pharma arm of J&J, for a long time. I joined 2 years ago, and they were already in the space, really doing a lot of interesting things, so both internal activities and external partnerships. And so it's really an exciting time to be in this field. Our immunology therapeutic area is pretty forward-thinking. We're open to a lot of new ideas and new explorations in that space. So, you know, I think it's important we're open-minded to these things because it's an emerging field. And I forgot to mention my background. I'm a Ph.D. biologist. Most of my experience is in cell and molecular biology. I have over 20 years' experience in both biotech and pharma. Most recently, I've held a number of executive leadership roles, including starting a company, so I know what you've been through. I have to admit, it sounds funny, but I know the pain of going through the learning curve and also the responses that aren't always the same. And I joined the J&J Innovation Center a couple of years ago, just when we started them, and it's just a great time to be involved in fostering external innovation, which we do. Although I represent immunology, we also, through our Innovation Center, cover our consumer healthcare business, device and diagnostics, and all the other therapeutic areas. I'm just a bit immunology biased.
So my name is Douglas Crawford. I work at QB3, and one of the odd things that QB3 is a University of California Research Institute, but we've spawned a number of private companies to do what private companies can do and the university cannot. And so that includes a sequence of incubators, one of which is the proud home of Colleen and Whole Biome. And then we also have a seed stage venture fund called Mission Bay Capital. And basically, we were motivated by the challenge so that the pattern set in 76 by Genentech was that if you had a clever idea, the sober up idea, the beer napkin, you drive up and down Sand Hill Road, you look for capital, and sadly, the story that Colleen tells is the Bayesian prior probability for, 99% of all entrepreneurs, 99.9%? And so one of the questions was, amongst those no's, are there great companies that need to emerge? And Colleen is a perfect testimony to the fact that, yes, there are great companies. So we said, well, how can we break that cycle, catch-22 cycle? You need money to get data. You need data to get money. How do you begin? So if you can break the money down to such tiny increments that Colleen can steal it from her kids' piggy banks, then we can enable a class of life science entrepreneurs that look like the tech entrepreneurs at Starbucks with a notebook that could create companies and build by a snowball emerging companies. So we have five sites and 87 companies, and every day there are super cool people doing just what Colleen is doing. And I think in this particular marketplace, we need Colleen more than in any other marketplace, because we know so little about what it's going to take to succeed. And startups are a real victory for evolution over intelligent design, right? So they're out just, they're in the just do it school. So Colleen in, 4 months went through 6 business models and is continuing to evolve both the technology and the marketplace without taking a lot of capital when she's really free to explore. And so that's our goal, that's what we're trying to do.
Great, okay. So first of all, I would just like to remind all of you that there's a number up there that you can text questions to, or you can tweet about what's going on and interesting things that you see and hear. I'd like to circle back. So Colleen, I think that you educated the venture community, basically. It's very nice of you to give them the tutorial. And I think that's what a lot of startups do, because after they told you no, then they went and called their friends and said, I just heard this amazing new business plan. So tell us about what you actually do. Like, if you can walk through that business plan, what happens in, say, a clinic or in a lab? How does that turn into data? How does that data turn into money? And then how does that get funneled back into your next thing?
So,
Karim, I'm gonna ask you the same question next.
So he gets some time to think.
Yeah,
I have to answer
right,
now.
You're...
Okay. So the fundamental premise of whole biome is that quality of data is what it's all about. So I think whenever you're in a new space, this is the key. And when I was doing my postdoctoral work, I was trying to identify biomarkers for Wilms tumors, and I was using microarrays, and that was when they first came out. And it was super noisy, and I spent a lot of time and energy and other people's time and energy pursuing routes that were not real. And I think a lot of people get burned by new technologies and new fields by doing that. And so what I learned from that is that when you're in a space where you don't know anything, the data has to be the highest quality. It should always be high quality, but it's imperative so you're not going down the wrong path. So we work with clinicians, and they collect patient samples, and they know all of the patient information, and they share that with us. Obviously, we don't have patient identifiers, but we know about the patients. They send us the samples. We process those samples and get a variety of different types of data. My two co-founders and I worked at Pacific Biosciences before we started Whole Biome. We're very intimately familiar with how to use next-gen sequencing to collect data. I think in the microbiome space, it's not just about who are the players, but what are they doing? And so collecting that data, both what are they genetically capable of, as well as what are they actually producing, and then feeding that information back with these clinicians and trying to understand, as a person's microbiome changes or as they go on therapeutics, how does that change a person's microbiome, is sort of the key type of data that we are developing. And so that's kind of the cycle.
Okay, so you have the gold standard assay for understanding what's going on in a gut sample.
Yeah, and I think the idea is that from that data, when you mine through it and you try to find new diagnostic markers or new therapeutic targets, you can have some degree of confidence that you've got maybe something real.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm going to circle back to you, and what I'd like to understand is a little bit about what's the physical versus the data processing that you put to that task. But Karim, can you tell us a little bit about what you do at Second Genome?
So we do something fairly similar. The lens by which we go about solving some of the problems around what do I do in that whole circle of diagnostics, therapeutics, services, etc., is to commit to a medical problem. So start by saying, where is there an unmet medical need? And that looks like a patient sample that you obtain. And I think at the end of the day, a lot of the microbiome work, at least that we perform, is a large scale molecular analysis of what happens in a biological sample. So if by getting biological samples from a space where there is a medical problem, meaning you have patients that are not responding to a given course of medications or medical intervention, if host microbial interactions are leading to a pathology, molecularly understanding how that is happening by doing next generation sequencing to understand the bacteria that are present, by gene expression profiling, how the host is responding to those, and then connecting what bacterial changes are leading to those host differences, we can start unraveling things, that pathways and mechanisms that otherwise we didn't necessarily know. Some things we know were hypothesized and demonstrated in hypothesis-based studies, but this allows us to take an unbiased approach to understanding that ecosystem, if you want. It is really ecosystem biology at a molecular level between the human and the microbes that are in or on us. So, by starting with a medical problem, analyzing it molecularly, we can understand what's that problem and devise a strategy by which to come with a medical intervention. So that's the data that we sell in partnerships or that we utilize to actually say, is there a new drug that can be used or repurposing something that already exists out there or something along those lines. So that's what we generate.
Okay. So, Colleen, you talked about, I think you were mentioning anonymizing patient samples and things like that. So how do you go from where you are, where you have generalized, anonymized data, to something that can be a patient-specific diagnostic or a patient-specific therapeutic? And Karim, I know you're a little bit farther down that path towards the market. So could you talk a little bit about that? Like, what's the timeline? You know, how long does that take? And what do you need to do to basically get that... make that progress?
The timeline is 17 and a half months. Is that right? Yeah.
Okay.
That's the unknown. That's the big gamble, right? So I think Karim is right. You start with an indication, or in our case, we started with what we consider, you know, a variety of indications, and say we don't know which one's going to hit, but we know that if we start collecting enough of this data and we know how to process that data and analyze it properly, we will start to see trends. So I don't have to know the patient's name, but if I know all the therapies they're on, I know all of their medical history, I know all the different issues that they have, I can start to then pull this data in with all of the expression data and genomic data. And, you know, the timeline from when you collect this data to when something starts to reveal itself as, oh, there's a new target there, or there's some diagnostic patterns here that we could maybe use, is sort of the big risk. That's the unknown. But I think that if you're lucky and you're working hard to collect the right data, hopefully you can shorten that timeline.
Okay. Karim?
You know, and Jackie can comment about this in you know, the typical drug discovery life cycle is an extremely long one, and that's what, you know, investors always have, you know, heart attacks each time when you give your timeline, so you end up just lying.
I've never done that.
Look, three of them just had heart attacks right there, just when you said that.
No, but I mean, typically, right, it takes about 4 to 5 years from an original idea to having a molecule that can start moving into safety studies. There are exceptions to this, rare diseases where you can correct a gene mutation by overexpressing a protein or repurposing a drug, or but generally speaking, if you're starting from an unknown, right, which is roughly what we tend to be doing in this space, and actually a very big unknown, even though the word is micro, it's actually a huge unknown. You can easily say it's 4 to 5 years to understanding what is going wrong and how do I correct that. So there are multiple ways of trying to actually accelerate this, and that's something that we are doing. One is obviously starting with human samples. That takes out all of the, you know, the sort of starting material. So you're going where the problem really exists by actually understanding what's happening in those human samples where the problem exists. So that's one way of shortening up that timeline. The second way is to try to find ways in which the intervention that's being used to correct the problem, whatever it is something that already exists, has been de-risked somewhat by other people, either in the marketplace, by other products. So I think what we can bring to the table is that shortening of a timeline there.
Okay, well, so
can I add something?
I was gonna say, Jackie and Doug, what, you know, you have to make money bets on these, you know, a lot of uncertainty. So how do you decide how much and when and things like that?
What I wanted to say, and maybe I'll sort of come to what you just mm-hmm. asked me, but I think it's important to consider in this field what the drug or therapeutic or what the diagnostic is, because in fact, the drug could be, and this is what Karim's alluding to, a small molecule that hits a target, a receptor of some kind, sort of the classic things that we do in pharma, but the drug could also be a consortium of microbes, which is something that we're doing through Vedanta. It's a consortium of microbes with a function, or it could be a metabolite of microbes that has a function. And so the timelines and the work it takes to get to those are different, and particularly for using microbes as drugs, that's not a well-trodden path, despite the fecal transplants, which is kind of Wild West, but people are doing it. But for using defined consortia of bugs, that's a really different process, and I think we're learning as we go. And it's also worth pointing out that there's a difference between a drug that's a consortium of microbes like we're developing through Vedanta, which is very defined, and we're taking it through a classic pharmaceutical pathway. And that's different from what you see in the consumer sector, where you can buy probiotics and prebiotics at the store, and they've gone through a really different regulatory path. And so I think it really depends on what you're talking about. And having worked in the diagnostic space myself, it takes a long time to qualify a diagnostic test. And you're really trying to make an impact on patient healthcare. And you have to go through a lot of hoops and a long process. And I think the microbiome offers that opportunity as well in diagnostics. But it's going to need to go through the same rigor, and the data needs to be really high quality if we're going to use it to make decisions about patient care. So I think the answer is it depends, and we all want it to happen faster.
So, and you can, I'm just curious, when you go to your colleagues and say, it depends, and I have a lot of uncertainty about this, but I think it's a $50 million investment. I mean, how does that conversation go?
You know, one thing I find really interesting and I really like about our company is, and I mentioned this before, it's the open-mindedness. And something that we decided when I started a couple years ago is that this is a really interesting space. It's not defined. It's not well understood. So we want to be part of the exploration. And so part of what we've been doing, and we have a lot of academic partnerships and a variety of company partnerships, and we do stuff internally, we're actually trying to understand mechanisms of disease. So Karim mentioned this before, but we're trying to understand what's cause, what's effect, because there's a lot of correlation in the field. And so those aren't the same discussions. It's more, what is the deliverable from this project? Are we going to understand or have an idea of which microbes are causing or correlated or whatever it is in a disease setting, but it goes back to human disease. And we're very interested in mechanism, because through mechanism, you can then define therapeutic strategies, such as what Second Genome does. And so some of it is about there are metrics for taking drugs forward. So a consortium of microbes, if it's going into the clinic, there are metrics around that and what it takes to develop it. But we're very interested in the research side of it as well, because we want to be part of finding out how this works and how we can make really novel solutions for patients.
So it just strikes me as a key difference between, say, Kosla or Kleiner Perkins and a strategic investor like J&J is, like, we want to understand the science. That's part of your motivation for making the investment, as opposed to we need to get 10x return, basically.
We actually have a venture arm of J&J, JGDC, but I'm part of pharma, and we're interested in really typical things like licensing small molecules, and it's the spectrum, at least for the innovation centers, of concept to clinical proof of concept. But a lot of our motivation, and we're very, very interested in finding novel solutions for patients, and we have a big initiative that was announced recently, but it's been going on since I started, to actually think about disease interception and ultimately prevention. And you have to do research to figure out what's going on in the disease in order to intercede. And so we do have a lot of a research focus, but we're a company that makes drugs and diagnostics and consumer products and everything else. So none of that's forgotten,
But I think we appreciate that if you want to do something novel and different, you need to understand the biology and the molecular mechanisms in order to get in there. And so that's with my pharma hat on, saying that.
Okay. Doug, how about you? You've definitely had to bridge the gap between science and venture investment, probably cross that hallway every day. How's that been like for you, looking at the microbiome space specifically compared to other, you know, other types of things that Mission Bay invests in?
Yeah, it's all about the uncertainty. So not that Porsche-driving, Tahoe-dwelling venture capitalists deserve much sympathy in this room, but let's give them a moment to contemplate the uncertainties associated with this subject matter. So, you know, there's this unrelenting attack on intellectual property, particularly in natural products, that may cast a shadow across this entire sector, except for the low-margin food end of the industry. Maybe that we cross that impossible mile of finding a novel set of bugs that are therapeutic, and we have the rug pulled out from underneath us by the patent law.
You can't patent the collection of bugs. It's not
we'll find out.
Okay.
Patents are being issued. No one knows. Time only will tell, right?
Excellent.
And then the regulatory uncertainty. So, you know, we basically, when we meet with young companies, they tell us stories about the FDA from the last decade or more, but we see an FDA that is evolving to wanting much more certainty about what they're putting into patients. So a gamish of bugs that are poorly defined, a bug that's poorly defined, is a cause of great anxiety at the FDA, and they may or may not become intolerant of that anxiety. Who knows, right? And then we have pretty good evidence around FMT, but the associations for cures for other indications for which it's really exciting include all the biologic risks of novel therapeutics, which don't always work out as we hope they would. You know, biology has been more complex. We add all those up, and it's like, God, so you just take those probabilities, you know, the 0.5 times the 0.2, but, you know, and you get out there. That has put a chilling, you know, other than Series and Second Genome and a few companies that have popped, it's been hard for most startups to get Sand Hill Road to make investments. Colleen, fair enough?
Fair enough.
Yeah. So I think one of the things we so greatly admired about Colleen is her ability to find solutions to that problem, which is to find people with data who want to pay her. Wow, that equation usually goes in the other direction, you know, and she had the people, academics, paying her to get validation for her work. So I think it's going to take really clever solutions like that to get through the initial divide.
Great. Yeah, I think it does sound like, I mean, if you just think about with one therapeutic, one person, their biome is changing all the time. You don't know, like you say, the precise mix of bacteria that you're going to be administering that can change. There's a lot of variability here. And then you say things like patent and regulatory, like how do you classify this? So this seems like sort of the singularity of uncertainties around commercialization of medicine. So if just as the last question before we start taking questions from the audience, that I've got some here. What's the biggest uncertainty that you really worry about? And, you know, how do you think you can address it? So why don't we, Colleen, it's been a while for you. You've had a chance to rest. What do you think?
The biggest uncertainty. I think one of the things that I'm most nervous about with the microbiome space is that there's been a lot of hype around and a lot of media attention to it. I mean, I can read in my fitness magazine about my microbiome now, which is pretty... not exactly where I'm normally reading about the microbiome. So I think one of the fears is that whenever something hits anything, like science, technology, and it's really big and people have all heard about it, and it seems like it's gonna be an answer, a solution to so many problems, that there's a huge letdown when the first product that comes out or the first couple products that come out don't hit the way everyone hoped that they would hit. And that can be devastating for a field. It can mean that people decide to hold their money back. It can mean that physicians start to doubt that and they don't want to collect clinical samples anymore for you. And so I think the biggest uncertainty is what's going to happen when these first products come out. How are people going to respond to that? And in this field that we all believe is going to make a difference in healthcare, is it going to continue to be able to flourish? Are we going to get through the hurdles of all the data we need to collect in order to really develop, you know, true therapeutics down the line? Can you make it past that? Can you cross that chasm? So I think that's sort of the biggest uncertainty, is just the field in general.
It's pretty big. All right, Karim.
So there are quite a few things that keep me awake at night relating to this. You know, you can argue that we did an okay job when we only had about 8,000 of our genes to deal with in terms of trying to find solutions. I think the greatest uncertainty is what makes us believe that when we add, you know, 100 times more genes, that we're actually going to be successful at understanding that. So it's a bit arrogant, I think. But at the same time, you know, I work with very, very talented scientists who are bringing together computational biology, patient sample acquisition, which typically did not happen that much in the early stage of discovery. Scientists from very different backgrounds, microbiologists, immunologists together. And I think that if we are able to solve the problem of the uncertainty of bringing different disciplines together to work harmoniously, to find out what is really going on between the microbes and the humans, I think then we'll be able to actually solve that problem. So I think, for me, that's where the biggest uncertainty is. Can we work together in different disciplines of science to actually solve these puzzles? Will we get out of our own way?
Multidisciplinary. Yeah. All right. Jackie, what do you think?
I almost don't know where to begin. Okay. As much as
you're uncertain about the uncertainty.
I'm a fan of the field, but there are a lot of things I worry about. I worry, to Karim's point, a bit about the quality of the data. It's an emerging field. The amount of genomic information is humongous, and I don't think the sophistication is quite there yet to deconvolute all that. There are some of the issues that plagued the early days of the Human Genome Project, you know, developing the right algorithms, the reference genomes, and to me as a biologist, things like standardizing sample collection and things that matter, because there's a huge amount of variability. And so as a little bit more of an end user of the data, I'm always worried. It always looks nice when all of the bioinformatics people have created a nice user interface, and then I don't know, is this real? There's that feeling. The second thing I just want to point out, because it hasn't been brought up, but I'm always worried about finding function, because I think in molecular mechanisms, and I mentioned before, there's a lot of correlation. I don't think the animal models and the biological systems, they're the same ones we use for drug development. And you see the frequent times when we can't correlate something in a preclinical animal model with what happens in patients. And I worry that there's an added layer of complexity working with microbes in those models. And so I think there's an imperfection built in. And the last thing I want to point out, again, because it wasn't mentioned, but I think it's really important, and I think Karim started to allude to this as well, but there's a tendency for scientists to be compartmentalized. And the microbiome, we're all really excited about the microbes, whatever they may be. They might be bacteria, they might be bacteriophage, they might be viruses, but there's a whole lot more going on, because you're really looking at something that's so exciting. It's the intersection of the microbial community with the host genetics, with the immune system, with the tissue microenvironment, and with environmental triggers. And I think that's really fascinating, but those are really different fields. And maybe someday we'll be at a point where we get everything sequenced, our genomes, our microbiomes, and everything else, and we know that we have, you know, a NOD2 mutation or whatever it is, and we can start intervening earlier in diseases by understanding these things, but it's a long way off. And so I want to get there, but I'm concerned about some of these things along the way.
What do you think? Well, it's been so depressing, I think I'm going to invert the question. So I think one of the great opportunities that we haven't mentioned yet is the possibility to do an end around the sclerotic healthcare system that we've built in bits and pieces over the last 100 years. And so I had some delicious yogurt upstairs, and there is a, you know, a really interesting chance AOBiome, a company in our community, did an end around traditional diagnostics by going direct to consumer for microbiome studies. Diagnostics is too strong a word. Information. I think that's one of the really cool opportunities here is that we could find brand new business models as well as new biology.
Yeah, there's a rumor, I think you might say, about 23andMe that one of the, this is a genomics testing company, that one of the reasons they drug their feet on their FDA filings was specifically to blow up the healthcare regulatory process. You know, just sort of highlight all the craziness with it. So I'll start taking questions from the audience, and I'm going to start with one for the whole panel, and it's really, I'm meshing two together. What are the biggest markets, food, pharma, skincare, and specifically, there was another a related question. What's the single biggest technical hurdle between where we are now and a microbiome-related pill that makes you skinny? So, the skinny market. So, applications, basically, what do you see? And maybe another way to look at this is you've got therapeutics versus more cosmetic or recreational applications. Why don't we, again, Colleen, why don't you start? What do you see?
So one of the things I've learned is that market can be defined in different ways. It can be number of people or amount of dollars. So I think when we talk about the consumer product versus the pharmaceutical product, the market for the pharmaceutical product in terms of numbers can get quite large. But consumers, that's a huge population of people. So within the consumer market, I think that there's probably the first company to come out with a consumer product is AOBiome, and it's a skin cosmetic. Sorry, I should take that back. I mean, there's all kinds of probiotics and yogurts and food stuffs, but they've sort of come at it from a microbiome company perspective. So, and it seems like from their first delve into this, there's a market for that. And I think that the gap between where we are now and how you're going to get your skinny pill is how much funding whole biome gets.
Okay, there you go.
There's a jar in your pack, right?
Get out your checkbooks, come up and get skinny. Yes. That's all you need to do. All right. Karim, what do you think?
I'd love a skinny pill. We're working on it. I think, you know, weight loss is a really difficult space, as we know just personally, but from a drug discovery standpoint. So I think the regulators, the safety, all of those aspects are real issues not to be taken lightly. I mean, I think, honestly, this space, microbiome research, has a lot of opportunities for a lot of entrepreneurship. You can come in with products as cosmetics. We know that we will all, you know, deep down in our own lives, do a bunch of weird things with our diets and what we do to our skins, et cetera. So there is a market for all of that, I think. And if you can have a clever marketing strategy and a product that shows some credibility, there's an opportunity there. I think for those who are in the business, such as Second Genome, to market regulated drugs that pass the FDA mustard and will have a pharmaceutical partner that will jump in to move it forward, et cetera, we're going to have to show the data that these products are safe, that they are effective, that they meet the claims that they are proposing, that they, you know, have an effect either on weight loss in a given duration that works better than a placebo, et cetera. So I think those are the hurdles that we're going to have to face. But honestly, I mean, I think there is room for everyone in the food product, in the cosmeceuticals, and in the pharmaceuticals as well.
I completely agree with that. I just think there's a huge opportunity in the consumer sector, pharma. I mean, if something performs like a typical drug that we use, for example, in IBD, we use anti-TNFs. Those sell billions of dollars worth. And if we had a microbial product, whether it be a small molecule derived from the microbiome or an actual consortium, it would make a lot of money if it worked, if it was safe. And in the consumer sector, there's a huge amount of interest in, we all eat our yogurts, and it has to be safe. And even beyond humans in the veterinary space, I mean, there's huge opportunity. I wouldn't rule anything out. But it needs to be good.
Yeah.
In cosmetics.
Or at least people need to believe it's good. at least in the consumer sector.
The, there's the whole placebo, nocebo, et cetera effect. So, yeah. Okay. Doug, any thoughts?
It's probably going to be C. diff because the biological uncertainty is smaller there. There's people further along in that. And my second guess would be acne.
Acne. All right. So C. diff, by the way, is an infection that really ravages the patients and can be apparently quickly and effectively treated with microbiome treatment. So sorry, and acne. All right. So the next question from the audience. This is just so fascinating. I have to ask it. Does mood affect microbiome or vice versa? Who wants to take that? Does mood affect the microbiome or vice versa?
So it's hypothesis, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's one clinical area where this relates to this question is in irritable bowel syndrome. So we know that it's a combination of diet, prior exposure to pathogens that may induce GI tract infection, stress levels, genetic makeup, variety of causes and factors will influence that. So, and it's known that people have demonstrated in many, many studies that in irritable bowel syndrome, there are alterations in the microflora and that diet, exercise, taking care of stress levels through obviously the exercise, and other methods will normalize disease symptoms, but people have also shown a normalization back to a more normal microflora. So if you take that as an example, it probably is the case.
Where do you think the expression gut feeling and gut reaction came from?
Yeah, we didn't get into all the puns. I did get, what's the industry's appetite for genetically modified probiotics? There's a lot of puns to go after in this space. So, why don't we take that? You know, here we are in this sort of nexus of anti-vaccine, you know, not my kid, blah, blah, blah. At the same time, there's chakra crystals and biodynamic wines and things like that. So, is anybody even looking at genetically modified anything? I mean, I think, the studies that you could do would be really interesting. So, again, any findings so far? Any thoughts on the GMO microbiome intersection?
I mean, there are companies that are doing that, strategically trying to develop bacteria that produce a metabolite or have a particular functionality of interest. So we're not doing that, but I think that the data that they generate is going to be really interesting. I think all of the hurdles that Doug was alluding to with regulatory are going to be tricky.
Okay. So the clinical trial is going to take place in Marin County.
But I mean, one comment about that: there is a lot of regulatory risk with genetically modified bacteria, but there is also an IP-related de-risking in that by genetically modifying, you actually create a patentable organism, if you want. And right now, that seems to be the only space for bacteria and probiotics where you can generate and carve out some IP for yourself. So I don't think that the idea of enhancing the beneficial functions of a microorganism should be something that is dismissed from that perspective. There's a lot of protection and uniqueness that can be generated in that space. And we are learning more and more how to genetically modify some of these bacteria. There's been a lot of work in Lactococcus, E. coli, et cetera, where that's fairly standard practice. But actually, with a lot of these bacteria that are less well culturable, I think that's something that's currently being learned.
Thank you, Doug.
Excellent point. I think that knocking off a risk is a good idea.
Yeah.
I was just going to say that I have talked to people that are trying to make genetically modified microbes, as you point out, to make a product of some kind, a metabolite. But I've heard more commentary from people that are averse to the idea because of the regulatory challenges. So I wouldn't think it's necessarily going to happen first.
Okay. So again, playing a little bit on Bay Area culture here, what role will do-it-yourself biology play in the microbiome space in the future? And I think this probably alludes to both, you know, diagnostics, therapeutics, and everything else. DIY bio, any future in microbiome there?
My favorite kind of do-it-yourself biology is paying attention to what you eat, because realistically, food is we take in food and it feeds our microbiota, and I think it's actually an undervalued area, because you can create huge changes in your gut microbiota and otherwise by eating well and avoiding certain kinds of foods, and I think it's something that should be considered a little more carefully.
I think when we think about the do-it-yourself or how you can change your microbiome, this is also a Bay Area thing where, you know, when you have children, it has been standard to try to keep them away from as many germs as possible. You have HEPA filters in their nursery. You are constantly wiping down surfaces. Good Lord, don't touch the dog. He's disgusting. And, you know, we live in a world where our mentality is, we don't want our children to be exposed to germs because that they could get sick. And I think one of the shifts that we'll see, and maybe it'll start in this area, is that that's not true. Take out that HEPA filter. Let the dog lick the baby. Hang out, you know, in the soil. Go in the backyard and play. Don't stay in the, you know, septic environment that we've, you know, antiseptic environment that we've created. And I think that that's a population change that will help diversify the microbiome. And as far as we can tell, reducing the diversity of your microbiome is what we're constantly doing in our very hygienic environment, and that may be a big problem.
You know what makes that absolutely worse is the extreme use of antibiotics, and that's something that I think as awareness is raised, people may decide they're not going to, or probably more importantly, it's giving a lot of antibiotics to very young children and babies, because you can basically taint them for the rest of their life by disrupting the microbiome, and if they have the right genetics and some environmental triggers, they end up with IBD. So I think people, there is some awareness that's being brought up. Marty Blaser's book, The Missing Microbes, came out not that long ago, and people are beginning to realize that antibiotics aren't candy, and they actually do something that's really bad. So people might self-limit the use of them, and I've heard people that have talked to me about doing that, and they said, yeah, now that we know, we don't want our kids to take them.
Yeah, and that's a great point. I mean, my first daughter was born 7 weeks premature, and standard ops for a preemie is course of antibiotics, and she was in the ICN for a month. It was horrible. She was on antibiotics, and of course, I'm in a microbiome-centric world now, and so my daughter she does struggle with IBS, and she has, you know, issues that I think are related to the fact that she started out at a very young age disabled, with a disabled microbiome. And I have another daughter that came along, she was a full-term baby, and she doesn't face any of those same problems. And these are genetically the same children. They're growing up in the same household. They just had a different start to life.
So we've had a lot of questions around probiotics and the efficacy thereof, whether the work that you're doing proves or disproves, basically what are we learning about probiotics and other types of, like you're saying, food, but food with a purpose. Where is that going to go? Are we going to ruin a perfectly good placebo by saying the probiotics don't work, or what does it look like?
Well, we were talking about it earlier, right? The story in New York where half of the products didn't really contain what they were supposed to contain and contained stuff that was not meant to be in there were there. So I think one of the things that we can start becoming is more honest about the usefulness of these products besides, just tasting good. So we can apply, now cost-effective technology to really monitor how much of a change is actually coming due to those products and really say, is there room for more health benefits besides just the nutritional aspect, which they're not necessarily dissociated, right, with respect to that. But is a probiotic bifidobacterium really good for you and why? I think we can start getting to those answers there.
But also might be that it's only good for some of us and not others, depending, which makes it more complicated. But it, I mean, we talked about this the other day, but it is a problem because some of the probiotics are microbes. They just come in a pill from the drugstore or the supermarket or wherever. But the quality control or the understanding of what's in them isn't really great. And so sometimes the microbes are dead and they're not supposed to be, or they aren't the same strains they're supposed to be because the methodologies used to quality control them aren't that rigorous. So I think that's one of the problems, is they aren't necessarily what they're supposed to be. But the second is, in making a product like that, it had to be demonstrated to be safe. It's not the same is what we go through to get something through the FDA to make a typical pharmaceutical. And I personally think it would be nice if some of these consumer products had a little bit more mechanism affiliated with them and a little more proven function. But then I work in pharma, so.
Yeah. Well, I think it's an interesting strategy, and maybe one we should talk about the, doing the sort of and run around the pharmaceutical regulatory process or the diagnostic regulatory process. We mentioned earlier, AOBiome, 23andMe is going to genealogy, and Scanadu is a device company that's kind of also going after consumer indications to get acceptance and data that then they'll use for a regulatory filing. So for those of you who are trying to commercialize these things, do you see that, is that a viable strategy for you? And for those of you investing, is that something that, would that change your perspective if Colleen said, we're going to go after the skinny pill first? Would she still be welcome at UCSF?
Absolutely. Actually, I think that's
she's even more welcome, right?
Yeah. She can do no wrong in my eyes. That's all right. So I think this is an area, one of the justifiable concerns is the imprecision by which people measure impact on themselves. We make really sloppy correlations about ourselves. But it would be great if the market would just solve that problem too by providing us with tools that gave us more accurate metrics for measuring ourselves in a way that could be meaningfully predictive. So, if you could track correlation between your diet and your microbiome in a way that really would predict weight loss in 3 months.
So you need like Fitbit and those guys to...
Yeah, microbiome, Fitbit, something that would be a little more quantitative.
Okay.
Could be the start of a way of ending around. If it's about anecdotal reports, we were having this conversation upstairs. We went thousands of years bleeding people without ever kind of correlating that it wasn't working so well. Yeah. So we're not necessarily very good judges of performance by anecdotal reports.
I'm just wondering if, this ties into one of the previous questions around what can, the Bay Area group do. We're I think, really connected with our devices and monitoring, our social lives and everything that we do, work lives, bank accounts, et cetera, in one device. So I think if there's a way of being able to marry technologically one of the most difficult to monitor areas, which is what do we eat, what is our daily behavior in terms of exercise, sleep patterns, medication, hydration, etc., and marry that with our medical information, whether it's healthy or disease related, and then add several lenses of personal genome, which is already being done. I'm sure some of you have paid. You can have your microbiome now sequenced also for a fee. And then try to now put that data together and in a way in which you can start extracting the information that says, what are the patterns, the molecular patterns that are leading to health? I think that's something that can be synthesized here as a business model, maybe by entrepreneurs out there or
so Nest companies. You should make a toilet. Anybody here from Nest?
Yep. I just feel like add to that, you being able to measure change is the most important thing. And one of the problems with the skinny pill or, as Doug is pointing out, monitoring diet is that people are big fat liars. I mean, I have a journal because I was told if you keep a journal about what you're eating and exercise, you know, what you eat and how you exercise, you will exercise more and eat things that aren't good for you. My journal looks something like this. I exercise and ate well on this day. I exercise and ate well on this day. I exercise and ate well on this day. And then there's like blank pages. And then it's like, I exercise and ate well on this. Those blank pages are the days when I was bad. And I just didn't put them in my log because I don't want to put that in a log. Yeah. And I don't think I'm alone. We don't want to look at that stuff that we're doing. And so if you don't have that data, that missing data is actually the key data.
Okay.
Can I just add something that is, sort of overlays this, which is something I find really fascinating about this field, is that I think I really like this idea of collecting all the data and integrating it and finding solutions for health in there. But one thing that I think we have to remember is there isn't one health. So what my microbiota might look like as a healthy person may not be what yours looks like as a healthy person, because there are many roads to get there. And again, it's that intersection of our biologies, our immune systems, our environment, our genetics, and the microbes, and plus the microbial functionalities are redundant. So you might have microbe A and I might have B, and we think they're different, but they may be making the same products for us. So I think it's an interesting layer that, as a field, we're going to need to sort that out, because we don't want to be saying, oh, you must be sick because yours doesn't look like our reference healthy person. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a challenge, but I think getting that kind of really aggregated data is going to be critical for that.
Yeah. So I had a couple questions about where the field's going. So I think the one that probably sums it up best, and we're getting close to the end, by the way, so if you have a question you haven't already sent it in, please do. There's the number. Where do you see the microbiome field in 15 to 20 years, if you can see that far? If you can't see that far, choose another time. Colleen, you know? You're looking like you don't want to answer.
Yeah, that's my look of don't call on me. Yeah. It didn't work very well.
Like blank page in my journal. Don't call on me for that one.
Okay. Well, you know, we've been through, we should remember how long, between poor Jesse Gelsinger dying in a gene therapy trial and the first approval for a product in Europe was 20 years, something of the kind. And so it takes that long for us to incorporate, to learn the lessons, and to really make use of this. 15 years is long enough so none of us will be held to mark, but this is a profound interactor with our global biology that we somehow sat on and ignored for a long time, and it's got to have a big impact. So I'm bullish.
You're bullish? It does have a little bit of...
I can't invest over a 20-year horizon, though, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. Yeah. Jackie, how about you? Any thoughts long-term?
No, I think that advances in sequencing and data analysis are going to make it possible. We'll all be monitoring our microbiota, but every once in a while I think, hey, maybe we're going to do all this really high-tech stuff, and in the end we'll just be eating food, as Michael Pollan would say. You know, it could come back to that's what it's about.
I'm just going to throw out a kind of a different tangential question. Any privacy concerns here? I mean, do we need the microbial equivalent of a shredder next to our desk to tear up, stuff? Or what, can you be identified by your microbial path through
the
world?
All we have to do is check the pets in your house, because theirs is probably similar to yours, from what I've been told.
Yeah, so NSA is going to take a keen interest in this this research. They take an interest in everything, so. Okay. All right. We've got I think we have time for one more question. Is that right? Yeah. Thinking about other entrepreneurs in the audience that might have an idea, it might be related to the microbiome, might be related to some other aspect of clinical or diagnostic products or applications that are, equally outside the box. Do you have any advice that you would give them? And for once, I'm going to pick on you first, Doug. Just do it. That
just
was easy.
Just do it.
All right.
We've enabled entrepreneurs with credit cards to get started, so just do it. You'll gather momentum, colleagues, investors, it will all come. Just do it.
Great motivational advice. Jackie, just don't do it. No.
I like it. Just do it. Except as a scientist, I have to say, make sure no matter what you do really rigorous science.
having been around that loop that you went through with the investors, I think just do it, but have really a clear product in mind that really addresses a need. I think that's the key thing that I've found. You can do a whole bunch of crazy things as long as you have a problem that's being solved with your idea, then you'll basically find the money and hopefully things will go well.
X people will buy Y product for Z dollars. That's the business plan. Yeah. Okay.
I think my advice would be to anybody starting a company in this space or any other is to not be afraid to be vulnerable, to not be afraid to be a rookie. Ask people for help, ask people for advice. Come talk to us, we're in the space and it's an open community. And I think that you will feel, there's humorous stories, there's laughter, there's tears. But I think if you understand that I'm in a process where I'm gonna learn a ton of things and I'm okay being that person who's not the expert in the field, you'll get there. I mean, we got there. We now know how to bring in revenue. We know how to get VC funding. We have a couple of VCs who have funded us. We know how to even get our lawyers to invest in us. I mean, you get there. And the important thing is knowing what you know and knowing what you don't know and being cool with that and being okay with learning, the learning process.
Hey, great, so it's a learning process. I do actually have one last question. You know, a lot of people here might be entrepreneurs, but we're all individuals, and we want therapies and diagnostics and things that make us, you know, feel better, live longer, be happier, and things like that. So if you could, just very last thing, what's the connection between the microbiome and personalized medicine, personalized wellness, you know, basically making us happier, healthier people?
I mean, I think that that's the potential of the microbiome, is to be able to, for each individual, figure out how to improve health and improve mood, maybe eradicate or at least temper various diseases. And so I entered this space because I wanted to change patient lives and improve lives through these sorts of therapeutics, and I think that that's exactly the promise of the microbiome.
When I look at the microbiome as an organ in my body, like my lungs or my heart or my brain, and I have to be in sync with it, because if I'm not, then there's going to be something that's going to be messed up. So I need to understand how to take care of it in its functionality. So the right food, the right composition, and you know, with probiotics, we try to do that, but it works a little bit. But I think that's where this whole thing lives. So it's totally personalized medicine, or personalized health, if you want.
I think the field opens up a lot more possible drug targets, a lot more possible diagnostics, a whole lot more potential for therapeutic strategies. And I just think that it's really exciting to see that, but also just back to something we think a lot about in Janssen is, I see that field as an opportunity for earlier interception in disease, and we just need to figure it out and get there, but it's really exciting.
You know, when Tom Kornbeck said in his autobiography that he was so depressed when he first came here to study work because it was all done. We had done all these really cool biochemical causes of disease, and he was a biochemist. He basically thought, it's all done. Can you imagine this panel 10 years ago? I mean, it would have been how many people would come to sit around to talk about gut bugs, you know? It's like, it's so cool that we keep unraveling the onion that is human biology in a way that offers us such terrific promise. So I think we have a lot to be optimistic about.
Great, well, very eloquently stated and summarized. So I would like to, less eloquently, but thank the VLab team for putting together this panel about the forefront of medicine and food and entrepreneurship and health. Thank all of you for coming, and do I need to do anything else to wrap up the... Okay, thank you.
Let's give a big round of applause to Mark.